I'm calling in tonight, friends, from the unceded traditional territory of Kamloops to Sewepnik, and let us continue the healing and reconciliation journey together. We are here in Canada, graced with the presence of Innu and Métis and many cultures from all around the world. Let us learn how to live together in a new and delightful way. Warm welcome to everyone coming in tonight, and I'm just looking quickly across the screen. Those of you who don't know me well may notice that I have to go very, very close to the screen in order to see it. Sometimes hard for me to track people. I can't quite see who owner is. Oh, that's Norm. He's the owner. Okay. His lighting is in a high contrast situation tonight. Anyway, good to be together. We have two more meetings in our fall 2021 term. Good grief, where did the time go? Well, I'm going to share a screen now. And we're going to have fun tonight. We're going to go and stay in the big group, go to smaller groups and do all sorts of things. But we're going to begin together. A little bit of an introduction to our theme, which is phonetography. It's sometimes called mobiography. It has all sorts of names. From an article, which I will send this out, the worksheet out to you if you'd like, because there's some good information here. From an article in photographyconcentrate.com, never heard of it before. There's three paragraphs I thought I would share with you. Unless you're one of those admirable people who carries their favorite camera with them at all times, at the ready, chances are that you often watch great photographic opportunities pass by you. Not quite there yet? Start taking photos with your phone regularly, and in no time, the world will be full of photographic potential. Unless you're like Norm and Brian Hunt, who leave your cameras at home, but you had your cell phones. Nowadays, most of us keep our phones with us all the time, which means most of us have a camera with us all the time, too. When I bought my last Android phone, which had all these special features photographically, I did ask the salesperson, does this still work as a phone? He thought it did, so that was good to know. Because of the advances in smartphone design, that camera does a pretty decent job. Awesome shots are now within your reach everywhere you go. You can easily practice your craft and add to your visual record every single day. But you need to build fundamental skills, as with any piece of technology, including SLRs, DSLRs, mirrorless, and so forth. Smartphone cameras are nowhere near as powerful as DSLRs, and even some point and shoots. The megapixel count is low, and they lack the manual controls that let you achieve shallow depth of field and super crisp shots of objects in motion. And the editing apps are nothing compared to programs like Adobe Lightroom and Photoshop. Well, that's debatable. We'll see. So what's the plus? When you can't rely on your technical or editing powers to create a great shot, you have to go back to the basics, composition. You need to think more about the light, the colors, the lines, the placement of your subject. Being forced to focus, pun intended, on those fundamentals will do amazing things for your photography. So as with any technology, the technology is great, but as a lot of people say, F8 and show up, learn your craft, practice, and think about style, composition, context, all that. Connections. This is probably the biggest advantage in mobile phone or mobile device photography. If you're taking photos on a smartphone, chances are that you'll want to share them at some point too. Plug into a photo sharing community like Instagram or Flickr and get ready to reap the benefits. You'll connect with friends and other photographers, gain valuable feedback, and get inspired. There are even stories of people gaining new clients, lucrative sponsorships, and entire careers thanks to their participation in these communities. What you won't find, I think, and this is my comment, I don't think you'll find a lot of bird or wildlife photography. That's long lens stuff. You can attach lenses to cameras. You can attach view cups so that you can study images carefully in the outdoors. But by the time you add gadgets to phones, well, you might as well just get the different sort of camera that's already set up with these things. Sports, I'm not so sure they are as good for sports. For macro, again, probably it's better to get the other devices, but you're always trading back and forth between opportunity and specific technical needs. So let's look at some imagery. And when we first started thinking about doing this, a bunch of people sent me stuff from all over the place. And I've included that at the bottom of this worksheet as bibliography, if you're interested. And I was astounded. I mean, with my camera, I can take some interesting shots, which are good resolution, good color. And with a little bit of work in Photoshop, I can tart them up to look pretty darn good. Well, there's people who have taken the art of mobile photography to an entirely new level. And it was Valerie who shared this video with me, and we're going to start 6 minutes in. This is a bunch of Irish guys who have set up and facilitated and worked with judges in an international mobile phone competition. Enjoy their accents, enjoy their banter. We're going to watch a few minutes of these images. Then I'm going to put you all in discussion rooms, and you're going to consider two questions, and you might have a pen and paper handy if that's helpful. Question one is, what did you notice as we looked at these images together, and what surprised you, if anything? What did you notice and what surprised you? So let's spend a few minutes watching this, and I'll enable the sound, optimize, and tell me what you see, Dave Whiting or Rick McCutcheon.
I see your full screen, Ken.
Full screen now? Mobiography?
Yep, bingo.
Interesting. It was fun to drop in your groups. Some people are totally in the groove. This is new technology, which is working for them. One of the smaller groups, three of the four, didn't even use the technology. And I think it's fair to say are a bit suspicious of it. I asked Angelina, who is a large format printer, how many of her clients have brought images for large printing. And in some cases, even an 8x10 was blurry. I'm not sure, and Rick McCutcheon, you might be able to answer this. Despite the fact the files are very large, especially in the iPhone, probably 12 and the new 13, are they still at 72 DPI? And what are the implications for that? Rick McCutcheon.
Well, we were talking a little bit about that, and I'm not an expert on this.
Yeah.
But was it you, Dave, who was asking, like, now we're shooting raw files, and when I bring them into Lightroom, that's almost an irrelevant question. Yeah. People are printing these up to 3x5. I mean, 3 feet by 5.
Yes,
feet.
That's right. Yes.
And the other thing to remember is that with computational factored into this, things like Topaz gigapixel can increase the size of the file significantly to the point that it's really quite remarkable what you can do. I mean, I'm with a lot of my colleagues who are saying in the talk, it still doesn't feel like I'm taking a picture if I'm not using my camera. But, you know, if I step back from that and think about what people are doing right now with these phone cameras, it blows me away when I see some of those images. I'm like, holy crap, like, wow, way better than what I can do with my DSLR. So.
Couple of people said, because I visited all five groups, a couple of people said, what I can do in my camera, I actually cannot do easily or at all with my current regular camera. And yeah, I think that's the difference, that you're getting raw files in these. Anyway, let's go back to Mobiography. And I have to say that the International Mobiography Competition is sponsored by a phone technology company, which is developing apps for photographers for mobile phones. So this next 4-minute segment actually provides some commentary and analysis of the images we've already seen. A lot of the images, someone had said, and I think this is true, they had a bit of an abstract feel, and obviously there's a lot of post-production, but in all cases, the gathering of the visual data was input from a mobile camera device. So let's go back to some commentary, and we'll hear a bit of the Irish guys, and off we go.
All on the Mobiography website. So please do go over and have a
visit. Are you hearing audio?
Take your time, because obviously in the video, you're only getting 3 or 4 seconds to look at the image, whereas you really should spend some time taking some of them in. Some of them are truly amazing. Andy, will we dive into the actual category winners?
Yeah.
Okay, let me get it up on screen. Okay, so up first, Brendan, you want to kick off?
Yeah, so like watching the slideshow there that you put together was fantastic, because like myself and Andy lived with these photographs for a considerable number of weeks back and forth, making sure that, you know, we judged every photograph, that no photograph slipped through the net. And then we got onto the process of, you know, getting on our shortlist, getting our honorable mentions, and trying to select a category winner for each one. And this photograph here from Lawrence Bouchard, you know, that it was an easy choice in the end, I think. It's a really, really, you know, simplistic, minimalistic photograph, but that it is just visually intriguing with the character making his way across the zebra crossing. And I think that, you know, again, being in black and white, that it's, you know, just two colors there, it's really striking. And I think, you know, that the care and composition to achieve this, I think it's a worthy winner. And there's, for me, I think when I'm looking at a photograph, I like photographs that get me to, you know, to question. And I'm very much questioning where the photographer was when he got this shot, at the perspective. And also, you know, this lone figure running across a zebra crossing, where is he? There's a lot to kind of, you know, dive in and enjoy with this photograph. Fabulous winner, worthy winner.
Stunning image. Andy.
Yeah, well, this was the category winner for Landscape and Nature by Dominika Kozowska. I hope I've pronounced that right. I mean, this was a popular image with the judges, and it's one of my favorites in the landscape category. I love the colors, the hues of autumn. I think they blend beautifully with the golden hues of a morning sunrise. And I love the way that the The subject, the fisherman, is just beautifully framed within a gap in the branches of the tree. It really sort of helps to add a bit more depth from the foreground of reeds and leaves in the in the front of the image. It draws the eye in. It's full of atmosphere, and it's just such a lovely image.
Beautiful. Brendan?
Yeah, with this one from Dominic Schultz, I think, you know, the people on portrait category, I think there was like really high quality images in it. And I think this is one that the judges came back to, that, like, you know, myself and Andy came back to it. It stood out from the very start. There's a beautiful tenderness to it. And again, I go back to what I look for in photographs is that it gets me engaged and, you know, wondering about what the relationship is between the two women. Maybe they're sisters, they're identical twins. Maybe the more I look at it, I love that even with the window light that's coming in, you can kind of sense the gentle breeze that is there. And it's just a beautiful, tender moment that is captured by Dominique. And I think it's just a wonderful photograph. I love the movement in the characters as well, that, you know, that if you were to do a sketch of this, I think it would make a lovely line. So again, there's a lot that I, you know, brings me in to the photograph.
Good. And Andy?
Digital art category winner. I'm going to pronounce this terribly wrong. Cecilia Tiago, I hope. That's probably, I hope that's right. this is quite an intriguing image, abstract image. It sort of blends the idea of the human element with, you know, the chaos and complexity of modern times, and really is sort of a testament to what you can produce with mobile apps these days. It blends a portrait with a self-created texture, and also taken through several apps to create these intriguing sort of wire line effects at the top and the bottom. It really is quite a unique image.
Excellent. And back to you, Brendan.
Yeah, and like Lumatouch, who are main sponsors for the competition, they took ownership of the moving pictures category, and that they judged it in...
We are going to go to the moving category, the video category, in just a minute. But any comments now that you've heard some of the commentary? An awful lot of the comments were purely compositional, although we did hear in the last one that the development of that last image, multi-layered, three primary layers of operation, was entirely manipulated on the phone through various apps. My question to those of you who use cell photography or mobile phone photography, do you use various apps, or do you simply export all your material over to Lightroom and Photoshop, or do you use in-phone apps? Dave, Rick, Isabel? Sorry.
I just transported into Lightroom.
Yep.
And FastStone, that's all I do.
Yep.
I'll be interested to hear what some of the others say. I actually have quite a few apps. And when I'm traveling now, I use my iPad Pro, and I have Lightroom on the iPad Pro. Mm-hmm. And it does pretty much everything that I can do on a desktop. Mm-hmm. But then I also have Snapseed and many of the others that you would know on the iPad Pro and on the phone. And I can actually upload to Flickr when I'm on the road, and it's pretty seamless. I've got I don't know how many apps I've got, but I use probably VSCO, Affinity, Snapseed a lot. I'm sure the others have others that they use as well.
Definitely, you've got to like tinkering, and you've got to be pretty good at it. Hard for me with the visual challenges, even working controls within camera, working on screens and menus for me is really difficult. And one reason I went to Fuji a few years ago is that they still have a lot of dials on the top of the camera, and that's easier for me, but that's me. Fuji has a wireless app in the camera, which connects to my phone, but I wouldn't say the technology is still very stable. It's better than it was at the X-T1. Now at the X-T4, I still have to work and practice pretty hard. If I really want to take some images over, I use a cord. Otherwise, I just take the card out, obviously, and put it through the card reader. But the desire of the manufacturer, most photographers, is seamless, wireless, Bluetooth connection. Some days are better than others. Any app comments from any other users? Thus far, what would the greatest advantage of these cameras be?
Size, for sure.
Size, portability.
You have it with you all the time.
Yeah, pretty well. There's a few people I think even sleep with theirs. I mean, they need to get a life.
It's maybe easier to post pictures after Facebook and Instagram and such.
It's a frustration of mine. I've often done event photography, especially in relation to my international environmental work. And so I would take nice images and then I'd say to people, well, I'll have these ready in 2 weeks. And they'd look at me strangely and they say, what use are you? And then they take a bunch of selfies and they'd have them posted within 2 minutes, you know? But that's the demand right now. Instant gratification. They'll eat the icing and who cares about the cake, you know? I mean, and yet, if you're working commercially, and I've got a very interesting commercial story to share with you in a minute, that's the client demand, you know? Now, we may not want to touch that at all, but I'll show you some stuff later that's just going to blow your socks off, you know? Yeah. Let's look at a video montage. I mean, this takes us to a new level. And I'm still wondering if as a club, we should maybe have one video session just for standard cameras in our next 6 months, because I know some people like, oh, who's the guy? He hasn't been around for a while, but we did stuff together. He also spends half his time in Mexico. He's always shooting video and he loves it. When I remember his name, I'll...
Bob McQuaig.
Bob, that's right. He loves doing video and he helped me out with some shoots a while ago. But here is another amazing video compilation, all in phone. So here we go. And that's good. And
Vanessa Fox, who created this, you know, wonderful piece of art using the technology that Lumitouch provides. And again, like I think with the other with the photographs, I think the video speaks for itself. I think we're going to watch it here.
Terry, who's done one of the live shows with us in the past, she's the co-founder of Lumitouch. She mentioned that this was the key defining thing for them on this video. So with that in mind, let's take a quick look. Thank you.
So of all the genres of photography, what's that one? Give it a one-word name.
I don't know about one word, but that's a millennial on with ADHD.
It's a very emotive piece, that's for sure. Like, it's portraiture, isn't it? And a lot of people have asked the executive and myself, I guess, to do something on portraiture for 2022. And so we've got that in our sights. I'm not sure what we just saw is in our sights. That was all out of one image, although abstracted and combined with all sorts of other layers. And you think, well, I'd never do that. But in your libraries, in your archives, if you got one image that maybe you've printed one particular way, but you might want to do something very, very different with it. I always tell the story of J.S. Bach. He was not an innovator, but he took what was in the French, the Italian, the German, and the English traditions and transformed them in combination, creating what many, including myself, would argue is the greatest corpus of music ever conceived, certainly in classical form, you know. But he put things together differently. Yeah. We are going to spend some time on slideshows, possibly as soon as January or February. I'm going to do a session with some others on how to put a slideshow together. And also I'm going to talk a little bit about combining music, resources, sources, issues you need to be aware of, and ways of doing that. I'll do that within Lightroom, but to the best of my ability, I'll talk about how that might be done within, for instance, Photoshop Elements, and maybe at least one more medium. But, you know, we spend a lot of time perfecting the individual image, and we're not going to leave that, for heaven's sakes. But I don't know, was it Julia Child said there's more than one way to skin a chicken? I can't remember. Let's look at just a few more collections. Let's go to Mark Nick. No, not that one. Not that one. Oh, I know why Mark isn't here, because he's on the wrong side. Getting better at this, but I'm still not totally. I haven't done it for a while either, I must admit. So, there we go. I mentioned Mark Nickel last week. He's one of my colleagues from the CNIB, and he is a blind photographer. This is his section on his website where he talks about his mobile image offerings. Again, he carries the camera with him, and his subject matter tends to be found objects, very much the stuff of ordinary life. If the lion will lie down with the lamb, occasionally the cat and the dog will get on well. Isn't that a great reflection in the glasses? That's really sweet. Ah, yes. Sometimes a picture is worth a thousand words or one. I remember the picture, the image that we saw in the presentation earlier with the elder man sitting in a hospital waiting room, head downcast, that told a story. Shadows. Oh, yes. What are they shadows of? This again is all handheld mobile photography. Ability to use light in different ways, architecture. Maybe you're going to an appointment on the 13th floor or 15th floor of a particular building. You take a quick look out the window and wow, there you are. This afternoon, Michael and I were running our dogs down at the Pioneer Park, and there were fabulous reflections on the water, just looking over towards Peter and Paul. The camera, the phone was with me. certainly the cameras now, and I think Mark, he would, because he's a technology guy, I'm pretty sure he has a fairly late model iPhone. There's no difficulty managing a wide variety of lighting situations. You can also be incognito. I mean, of course, the Leica was the classic street camera of Henri Cartier-Bresson and others in certainly Paris, New York, and London of the 30s, 40s, and 50s, and the Fuji X100 kind of took that market back a little bit. Their new XV5 or something like that, $1,700 for a little tiny camera, but I think it flushes toilets. I mean, good grief, I love that one. Great lenses. Managing the highs and the lows. Beautiful color there, eh? Oh boy. Sitting waiting for something. It's obviously outdoors, probably at a sports field. I don't know. Great depth of field. Great portraits. Environmental or otherwise, good landscapes. You get the idea. I want to introduce you to someone I visited with her a little bit when we were down on the coast. I tried to get her to come to our session tonight, but she's a bit shy. I call her here a cold water swimming goddess. I mean, she's a West Coast girl. She just breathes the spirit of the seashore and the forests of Southern Vancouver Island. Her name's Leanne Eddington, and there she is. She doesn't even own a computer. She sells her work, often blown up to certainly 11 by 17 or probably even 2 by 3 feet. She doesn't own a computer. She does everything, all her shooting, all her processing, exporting to London Drugs or other places, a lot of printing on canvas, all from her iPhone. They're folk art images, I think you'd call them. She pushes things in a very vivid direction. She sells. And that's why I was sorry that she couldn't come, because I mean, if someone's thinking of starting a small scale business, she knows how to make it happen. And they're folksy little things from Dr. Seuss. Oh, the places you'll go. Today is your day. Your mountain is waiting. So get on your way. Lots of seashores, really punched up, vivid, quite emotive stuff. And she sells. Where do you want to go next? Surely that's just north of Souk. Stoked Pizzeria, I don't know where that is. Landscapes, that's, I'm pretty sure, Whitty's Lagoon and Machosen. For me, a little bit overdone, but it works really well when it's printed. A nice stylization of poppies. She sells these to her friends, and she sells in people's front yards and backyards. And she sells. What they call Ocean Beach or Esquimalt Spit, right by Fort Rod Hill Lighthouse. And we even get her shadow in the bottom there. Little bit of a self-portrait there. She also puts her images on all sorts of things, including pieces of wood, sometimes jars, small furniture. Very resourceful in her export. That's her. That is Phoebe. Michael, tell us about Phoebe.
Well, Phoebe is a 3.5-year-old Labradoodle, and I struggle with Phoebe because of her blackness and whiteness to get definition and actually to get her eyes. And this particular picture was taken this afternoon by Kathy. It's just marvelous to me that you know, with all of my equipment and expensive lenses and so on, and hours of trying to get Phoebe to pose and then trying to manipulate the images, that Kathy picked up her smartphone, took a snap, and got a pretty nice picture of Phoebe.
Yeah, and it was spontaneous. The room was fairly dark. There was a bit of mottled light coming in through the living room window. Problem with dogs, especially black and white dogs, if you shoot them outside and in any kind of sun, you end up exposing for the whites and you'll totally lose the blacks. You can bring them up in post-processing. But I thought this was such an interesting image because of the light being so diffuse, so kind of modest, it really flatters the blacks on her and gets some nice detail on the whiskers. Now, I think the shutter speed was fairly slow because it is a little bit blurred. Kathy, though, has a benign essential tremor, and so she's always fighting with motion with her hand. I think she has stabilization on, but I'm still not quite sure. But Michael's right. You can see the catch light there, which is the living room window, and it just flatters the eyes. As Brian Mitchell has told us before, because he shoots a lot of dog imagery, dark dogs, black dogs, black labs are really hard to shoot, but this just flattered her head and brought out her eyes in a sparkly way. And with a little bit of touch-up, we could sharpen it up a bit, put a bit more of a vignette on it. She's totally relaxed on our living room couch, which our dog was not impressed about because she's not allowed on the living room couch. And we got a real nice shot. And Kathy has, I think, like Isabel, the iPhone SE. So, you know, yeah. Well, how am I going to take this home here? We've talked about that. Oh, yeah. Okay. Tips. Before I share the screen, what do you think people would have to do? What are best practices for mobile phone photography? What do you think? Just spit out some ideas.
Composition and shoot, shoot, shoot.
Yep, yep. What else?
Remove the fingerprint filter.
Ah, that's a good one too.
Just make sure you set it set up. You know, there are so
many. Couldn't quite hear. Can you speak up a bit?
Make sure that you've gone through your preferences and set it up so you're shooting, you know, pro raw. Mm-hmm. Manual control is completely available on a lot of these now, so you can do pretty much anything, but you do usually have to set up go into your preferences of your camera app.
Yeah.
And I think when you do that, then it really just becomes all of the other good tips you would expect around composition, lighting, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes, with all photography, know your equipment. Practice with your equipment at home in the comfort of a chair with good lighting. You know, it's like music, because I pursued a performance career back in my 20s. And we used to say, you practice, and at your lesson, your performance ability was about 100%. And then you took it to a local performance setting, whatever, and you'd be about 60%. Because when you combine distractions, interactions with other musicians, nervousness, bowel gas, whatever, you're just not quite up on your game. So make sure you really know your equipment well, and it'll treat you well in return. Well, here's what one website showed me with regard to tips for good photography. Close to what Robert said, clean the lenses. They still need cleaning. They may be smaller. I've got 4 on mine, and you've probably got 3 or 4 on yours. Set the focus to ensure your subject is always sharp. I've never done this on mine. I've got an LG Android, but it's a pretty darn good phone, I think, but it's about probably 4 years old now. I haven't figured out focus yet. And as you know, I struggle with focus all my life. Adjust exposure. As Rick said, you don't have to shoot auto all the time, but if you go off auto, you'd better know what you're doing. use HDR, high dynamic range. And mine seems to be preset to shoot HDR all the time. And when people send me images for Facebook pages that I monitor, they seem to be sending me everything in an HDR format. Again, learn your equipment, read the manuals, get iPhone or Android for Dummies, and prepare. Shoot in portrait mode, and I'm not quite sure, probably I guess that's a focus thing, giving you some good bokeh. Again, if you want to shoot portraits, then the great advantage, you know, you're sitting at the airport, you've just found out your plane is delayed another 2 hours. Well, with permission, you could take some folks' photographs and have some fun with them. You could show them to them, as Dave Whiting always does, get their email and send it to them. They'd love it. Switch between iPhone lenses to zoom in or zoom out. I have no idea how that works, and we won't get into all that now, but it sounds like it's possible. Keep your camera steady for sharp, shake-free shots. That's standard for all cameras. Image stabilization in lenses or in camera bodies is phenomenally good now. With my Fuji, I can shoot without real concern to about 3 stops lower if I need to. That's good to know. Composition still important. Still think about the rule of thirds. Use leading lines. And we all know about that because we've had a showcase about leading lines and curves and such. The next Kappa competition, which Brian is going to talk about in just a minute, Brian, that will be important too. Experiment with different perspectives. That's obvious. So many times, you know, I'm working a subject that's in front of me, and now I remember most times to turn 180 degrees and see what's behind me. Half the time, I get a shot from that, and often it's very good. Simplify your compositions. Mads Iversen showed us how minimalism and shooting pieces of a setting often give us more bang for our buck. So a lot of these apply to all for the photographic endeavors, but are especially relevant, I would think, in relation to mobile phone photography.